convinced that it is a counterproductive long-term strategy. It is unlikely that any camp will prevail completely, and if perchance one did, mediators and, most important, disputants would lose the precious values of diversity and choice. So we have one model, whatever the heck we want to call it, right? The recognition that there are other models out there that might be doing something that is effective for other things, and that has value in of itself.
But see, I think it still gets back to another quote you quoted.
Great.
Which is that, which is the effect of mediators wanting business. And because they, you know, if they're private and they want to do mediations and they want to make a living at it, what's evolved is, and I can't remember who your quote was, is that basically, as long as we don't impose the decision, we'll give the parties anything they want. Whatever process they want, we're gonna, you know, adjust ourselves to what's gonna be useful for them and what they may want us to do. So then what happens to mediation? I mean, that's why I think my definition for mediation has just become, you know, it's a process where the third party doesn't impose a decision, because then everything else is up for grabs in some way.
But that's your definition of mediation?
Well, I mean, that the very essence of mediation. Because again, confidentiality, you know, maybe that's important in one kind of mediation, and in public policy mediation, confidentiality isn't important. You know, I mean, all those things are up for grabs, you know.
But you're saying that is mediation, that's okay.
Well, I don't like it personally, but okay. It's what it's about to be, that it's whatever the parties want me as a third party neutral. Maybe they don't even want me to be neutral, so a third party to do. But to me, where it's like it bottom line crosses the line into something else is if that third party imposes the decision. But that's where I think it's just getting.
But do you evaluate what we've traditionally termed an evaluative mediator? Do they impose a solution?
No. So it becomes mediation.
I mean, it's still just a suggestion that could lead to, you know, more informed decision by the party.
Which I think is another standard of conduct, right?
Yeah.
Informed decision making.
Unless it's changed with the new ones that haven't reviewed yet, but they are potentially passing shortly. So then it goes back to, okay, well, if all of these different definitions are mediation, and we started out with, you know, the whole purpose of at least this continuing ed was some confusion about, you know, what it is that we call facilitative mediation, when we have all these other people coming in and saying, I'm a facilitative mediator, I should be able to mediate with you guys, and they do nothing, seemingly they do nothing like our model. How can we better promote what it is that we do? And can we? Is this now so sophisticated and so detailed to get into all those different issues that it's unusable by the public, which is one of its purposes, right? To help people talk about decision making. And so then do we go back to the original and just continue with the facilitative evaluative continuum? I mean, is it just easier to continue to say, well, we're facilitative mediators. That's what we do. But through this self-reflection, we know what the differences are.
It's sort of funny, so you could advertise yourself as a directive, broad problem identification.
Yeah.
Right,
is that
right.
Useful? I mean, do clients even care? I mean, a lot of the private practitioners that we've had the opportunity to speak to, I mean, the number one question they get is, what's your fee? It's not, what's your mediation style?
Okay, so while Riskin feels that the original grid is not sophisticated enough to really reflect what's happening in the field, and even though the ADR community itself has gotten more sophisticated, clientele hasn't, and they don't know about all the differences unless they've taken Lynn Cohn's representation and mediation course, which is fantastic, right? Not just what you guys are taking, but some of us were with her at Mayor Brown when she talked to attorneys and what they should be looking for out of a mediator. So if our clientele isn't that sophisticated on the differences, then do we even need to call ourselves facilitative versus evaluative? And now we're back to 1970, whatever, when, you know, this field really just started. What do we do?
Shouldn't you be able to explain our support? Shouldn't you be able to explain to them, you know, I personally am a facilitative mediator. Here's what that means. Here's why I choose doing it this way over the evaluative model. Because if I'm evaluative, then it might, blah, blah, blah. You say, but there's.
So doing a combination, using those terms that we're most familiar with, but explaining them maybe now with a deeper awareness and understanding of
why. They're just labels, and yeah, the whys tell you that, you know, this is why I decide to do things a certain way in this situation. And, you know, there's other people who disagree with me. They're wrong, of course.
Nina?
I have found this very interesting and useful. However, it's only a tool. It has no objective thing for who or what we are. And I think if we view it that way, we'll say to people what we think is useful for them. But I do not think we have to go into a mediation and produce what we just want to do. In any form.
So we have a better maybe awareness, a deeper understanding of how we approach things. That is in and of itself useful, but how we describe mediation to other folks is still going to depend on their understanding and how much information they've had, so how we frame that.
I think that's great.
Any other comments or questions? Stephanie.
It's useful also, you and I have talked about this, but and you mentioned it at the beginning, but just as the field grows and changes, we're going to be seeing so many more, you know, Stanley and Cookie, I know a couple of you are at the ACR meeting last week, and some of us who are trained here were, like, it was hard to even watch what the mediator was doing because it's so different from what CCR philosophically believes in, but it's a reality in the field now that there's these other forms of, even if we don't think it should be called mediation, supposed mediation happening. And so I think it's important for us to be able to think about that and talk about it in order for people, mediators even, to make informed decisions about if I'm going to do this as a profession, you know, outside of CCR, what do I believe is important? When do I, you know, for us to really think through what we're deciding to do as mediators and to be able to have these sorts of conversations at things like ACR or, you know, different places where you're seeing these different models being done and to find out if there are bits and pieces of different models that could actually work within the CCR model.
And a recognition that I think as many people have said, CCR is an organization and there is administrative, you know, policies that have been in place, and so this is a model that we do in order to be able to have 200 volunteers out there mediating with the courts. But as individuals, you know, our volunteers maybe try some different techniques and things when they're out there mediating privately. So just recognizing what it is and why CCR has a pretty narrow definition of how we want to approach the mediation and why we think it's so great. With all the fabulous benefits that it, you know, brings about.
There seems to be like a great benefit in CCR promoting its particular model. Whether, I mean, yes, within facilitative, and the fact that there are other facilitative mediators that kind of don't really know this model, the fact that CCR presents this particular model does represent a consistency, you know, at least within some realm in the approach, but then you're selling, basically, when you go to your boards and the people that you provide
right.
services to. So that makes sense in terms of it being a label, and but labels are always kind of, they reach a limit of usefulness. After a certain sort of broad categorization, it's like, they become meaningless. Like, that's when you start to really look at it. I mean, even when I was listening to Cookie talk about facilitated being sort of looking like it's at this other end of the spectrum, well, I'm sure there's going to be stuff beyond that end of the spectrum where you're going to look at, well, a facilitative mediator is still talking, still in the room, and then you start to wonder what is it worth having a third party in the room? What are they doing? I mean, it's sort of Janina's point. But I mean, they are asking; they're choosing what to reflect. That's still editing. I mean, as a filmmaker, we got into this a lot in documentary work,
mm-hmm.
and it's in fact, I think the physicist Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. He says anytime you observe an event, you influence the event. You cannot make a measurement without influencing the event. And it's, you know, so to recognize that you're there and that you have certain standards for being there and behaviors that you're accepting that you're doing is really good, and to know about them and to understand that, just by editing your questions or selecting your questions, you're directing somehow. You're making this process happen differently than if you weren't there.
But maybe if that's a truth, then this construct that he's created for a system, it can't be all that useful. Because if you, just by being in the room, you know what I'm saying? Like,
it's useful to other mediators to talk about your style. But I don't know if it's useful, like the gentleman, I'm sorry, I don't know your name, was talking about to clients. Is it useful to them? I doubt it.
I mean, I can't think of any profession that advertises the nuances of how, you know, someone's a doctor or an attorney, a teacher, or, you know, a specialty maybe, but who goes into their whole description of
how I go about each decision.
What's your
and
bedside,
how I
approach. You know, what doctor tells you about their bedside manner? If they did, you might have better.
If they even knew that that was a topic, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, so much of it is so subtle. I appreciate that quote shared. Like, I did a mediation this week where this dad said, I just asked something about an intake. He said, yeah, and I want to talk about intake. He said, I knew right then that you were biased. And I said, really? I said, that would be helpful for me. You know, I'm sorry I gave you that impression. What was that? He said, when you spoke about that we're going to be bringing the kids to the second session, you first looked at their mother, you know, before you looked at me. And they were on opposite sides of the room. It wasn't possible to look at them together, but I first looked at her. He said, so I knew you were biased. You know, and so it was so interesting that he came into that session with that attitude, you know, that
very
release.
Charged.
Uh-huh. So I said, well, thank you for telling me. I really appreciate that feedback.
So then we take it. Him first, would that have been a suggestion of no bias or a bias?
Oh, that's a great question.
I guess he expects you to look up. Somebody's going to bring the children.
So now we have influence just in our body language.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I appreciate all the comments. I think it's really important for us as practitioners to be self-reflective and really think about why we make the choices that we make. And every step, you're obviously making a choice of how you want to approach a situation, whether it be the procedural decision-making, the substantive decision-making. I think the meta-procedural decision-making is particularly interesting and difficult to look at sometimes. But I think in the end, it's just about self-reflection and being aware of the much larger field out there besides just CCR and our model. Whether or not in the end, you know, we still feel like CCR is the model, and it is the most effective at reaching those benefits, which, you know, I would argue it is. But knowing that other people are out there practicing other things that are quite effective in themselves. So thank you very much for attending and providing so much great discussion.
Okay. And I'll put the copy.
Huh? Oh yeah, so if you want a copy of all the slides with the different grids and things,